We have the privilege today to have a special speaker with us this morning. Victor is president of the Baptist Convention in Cuba. And as he comes to speak with us, it's different though, because lots of times we have guest speakers, we say doctor, and sometimes your last name, so I say it right.
Gonzalez.
Okay. And Victor Gonzalez is a doctor, but he's not a doctor like Tawa is a doctor of, he takes in apologetics. Not a Bible doctor like that. He's actually a physician, and he works in the area of cancer, and he's an oncologist, and so he comes to speak to you this morning. He comes as, in that sense, he's just like any of the rest of us. He's a lay person, and he comes, and he's the first Baptist president that's been a lay person in Cuba. So he has opportunity to speak all over the place, and his dad's a pastor. His dad is 92 years old, and he still preaches and still speaks. And so it's kind of like my dad, who's going to come and speak in a couple weeks for us while I'm away at camp. And but 20 years older almost than my dad, so that's amazing to me. He's going to give us a little bit about his story, and he's going to speak to us and share God's word with us this morning. Tell us a little bit about his country, I'm sure, and I know he has a little video clip for us too. And do you want to show that, or do you want to introduce that clip? Okay, we'll invite him to come now and to share with us God's blessing.
Always almost 92 years old.
preaching, and my mother was a mission, Cuban missionary. They both studied at the University Seminary, Baptist Seminary in Havana. When I was one, all my life, my father and my mother teach me how to love the Lord with all my heart, with all my strength, with all my mind, with all my soul. When I was 12 years old, I remember one of the friends of my father was visiting the town where my father was pastoring, being at the Rio province, the western province of Cuba. And one morning he was talking with me about my faith in the Lord. And I remember that pastor, he asked me, are you a Christian? I said, yes. My father is a pastor, my mother is a missionary. And he asked me, he told me, I am not asking you if your father is a pastor or if your mother is a missionary. And I'm asking you, how is your personal relationship with the Lord? I said, I come to the church every Sunday, every day. He said, no, I am not talking about attending the church. I am talking, how is your relationship with the Lord? At that time, I understood that I went to the church, I grew up in a Christian home, but Jesus was not in my heart. And at that time, August 1973, I received the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I was baptized 2 or 3 months later. And since that time, it's a privilege for me to walk with the Lord. This is my first purpose this morning. That all the youth people here, maybe you have the privilege to have was born in a Christian home. It's a great privilege, but no, it's not all. You need to have a personal relationship with God through your faith in Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, I was born in Cuba in 1960. January 1st, 1959, President Fidel Castro put the bomb. And at that time, in the 60s and 70s, was a very hard time for the Christians in Cuba. Many Christians left the country, they moved to America, they moved to other countries, and we suffered discrimination for our faith in Jesus Christ. I remember when I was a boy and I was to the primary school, many times the teacher asked, who are the boys and the girls attend the church? And nobody raised their hands, only I raised my hand. And some of my parents laughed, you know, it was very hard. And the Christians in Cuba suffered a lot of discrimination during the 60 and 70 years. But beginning in the 90s, the Lord began to open doors for the gospel in Cuba. And right now, by the grace of the Lord, we are living a great time of revival in Cuba. Let me show, in 2007, we began a big crusade of prayer for Cuba for Christ. Every day, from 7 to 6, 6 to 7, 12 to 1, and 9 to 10 p.m., we ask for all the Christians to take at least 1 minute to pray for Cuba for Christ. Every Monday is day of fast and pray for Cuba for Christ. And every October 10th is the national day of prayer for Cuba for Christ. I will show now a video of one of the singers in Cuba. He was a famous singer for a non-Christian orchestra, and now he's a Christian. And he's asking in that video to pray the Lord may heal in Cuba. That song is asking the Cuban Christian people to be together praying for Cuba for Christ. Please. The prayer changed the sins. Change the sins in our life. Prayer changed the sins in our families. Prayer changed the sins in our world, in our nation. We are praying every day for Cuba for Christ. For me, it's a great privilege. I praise the Lord how I see in the last 50 years how the Lord and the Holy Spirit is moving in Cuba. I saw that I don't have ready with me now the bishop, but I promise me and I will join to the mission. to give up a story. There are homeless or Chinese youth people in Cuba that they have a right to Cuba for a study, Hispanics, I don't know. And in the first band pictures of the Havana, there are more than 20 Chinese youth people that they have received the Lord and that they have the meeting there. They arrived to Cuba without the Lord. They didn't know nothing about Jesus, but they have received the Lord in Cuba. And now they have a small Chinese congregation in the Carmel Baptist Church in Havana. It's good to me that I mentioned it. When I was a youth people, I took the decision what I would study. At that time, I was dealing in my life to be a pastor or to be a doctor. I was dealing in my life with cancer problem because the mother of my father, she suffered cancer for more than 25 years. But at that time, the end of the 70s, only a few pastors in Cuba, and I must take the decision to be a pastor or to be a doctor. But because my mother, my grandmother, I said I will be a doctor. The Lord opened the door in very hard time for the priests to attend the universities. I went to the medical school. I graduated in 1984 for a medical doctor, and after that, I attended the National Institute of Cancer and graduated as an oncologist. And let me tell you, in Cuba, the doctors is not like in other countries, a business profession. Because the doctors in Cuba has one of the lowest salaries in Cuba. But for me to be a doctor, to be a Christian doctor, is a ministry. Every Tuesday, I can share with my patient about the faith in Jesus Christ. I work in a public hospital. Of course, I cannot pray officially, but many times I close the door of my office and I ask my patient, do you like that? I pray for you. They say yes. Sometimes for the second or the third visit, I forget and my patient asks me, that you will pray for me? I close the door and I pray for my patient. And how wonderful is to share with the people our faith. People without hope. People thinking, I have cancer, I will die. I will know about my life. That you can share that in Jesus Christ, we have abundant life. We have eternal life. We have many blessings. What I encourage all the people is that you use your skills. You use your profession. What you're doing to share the faith of Jesus Christ with your parents, with your fellows, with your people that are around you. I am the president of the Baptist Convention in Western Cuba. In Cuba we have two big Baptist Convention, the Baptist Convention in the Eastern Cuba and the Baptist Convention in Western Cuba. Both conventions were organized in 1905. My convention was organized February 6, 1905 with 9 churches, and today we are 323 churches, more than 500 missions, and more than 22,000 members of the Baptist churches. And also in the Eastern Cuba, there is a pre-government, they are largest than my convention, almost 500 churches, 26,000 members. It's a good since how we see how the Lord is blessing Cuba with the gospel. In this morning, I will invite you to open your Bible or look in your iPhone or look to the screen, beneath the screen, in a chapter of the Bible that is Luke chapter 7, and we'll look for 11 to 16.
His disciples were a large crowd who followed him. her that he was his mother's only son, and she was a widow. A large crowd from the city was also with her. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her and said, "Don't cry." Then he came up and touched the open coffin, and the pallbearer stopped. And he said, "Young man, I tell you, get up." The dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him to his mother. And fear came over everyone, and they glorified God, saying, "A great prophet has risen among us, and God has visited his people."
The last verse, God has visited his people, is the title of this message that I like to share with you. Father, we thank you for all your blessings. We thank you for your word, word of life. We thank you for the wonderful blessing to be today in your house, praising your holy name, glorifying your name. And now we ask that the Holy Spirit may use this word for the encourage of my brothers and sisters from this church here in Edmonton, Canada. We ask for all the people here, you know, our needs, our family problems, our situations, you know, all the problems about our nations. We ask that the Holy Spirit may guide this moment, and all this work may be for your glory. In the name of Jesus, amen. God has visited his people. If you see the Bible, there is in the Bible many times when the Bible says that God has visited his people. What I like to share with you is what a blessing is when you see in your life that the Lord is visiting you. Many millions of people are lost in this world without the blessing to have the visit from the Lord in their life. But what I like to share with you in this morning is what privilege we have when the Lord visits us. If you go to the Bible, you see, for example, in Genesis 21, verse, Lord, the God visits Sarah, and she was pregnant and had a baby. Also, the Lord visited his people Israel in Egypt, and he gave the freedom from Egypt. The Lord visited his people at the country when they had very hungry, and he provided the food. Also, when Mary was pregnant, and the angel came to the prophet, he said, "The Lord has visited his people." In this passage in Luke number 7, 11 to 16, there is one of the stories that I enjoy in the Bible. This is the story that may ask us to think in our world today. Jesus is coming with his disciples. At the moment, he sees a very big crowd, and the people crying, because they are in a funeral. I don't know how it's here in Canada, because maybe this is a big city, Edmonton. But in Havana, that is a small city, and in my town, mother town, in Minadari, when we are walking on the street and we see a funeral, the people passing, you know, we feel respect and we stop because we think what happened with that family and what's sorry with the family. It was happening in that moment. Jesus is coming with his disciples, and he is coming in the name that town. At that time, he see a big crowd and the people crying because one mother has lost his only one son. He was a widow. That means that she lost her husband. We don't know when. And now she lost his only one son. At that time, what I like that you know is that the visit of the Lord moved to compassion. If you go to the Bible, and you are there, you see, when the Lord saw her, he had He had, well, he had compassion. Compassion. And when the Lord visits us, we must have compassion with us. Jesus saw the poor crying, suffering, and he was moving to compassion. My brothers and sisters from Canada, we cannot forget that we must move our life to compassion for the people that don't have the Lord. Sometimes we think that the church is like a fellowship, and the church is a fellowship. We think that we come from the church because our father and mother come to the church. We think that we come to the church because it's good, it's nice, the music, good music, but we are here not for only for fellowship. We are not here only for because our family come to the church. We are not here only because we have here good music. We are here because we are disciples of Jesus Christ. And because we, one day in our life, we have a meeting with the Lord. And the Lord forgives our sins and he is our Savior. But many people around us, in our family, in our neighborhoods, in our communities, they are lost without Jesus. And we must feel compassion. We must feel sorry by the people that don't know the Lord. Because we are not talking about religion. There are a lot of religions in the world. Many people have religions. We are talking about relationship with the Lord through Jesus Christ. For that reason, when we see a people that don't have Jesus Christ, we must move to compassion. And it was what happened with Jesus Christ. He felt compassion for that woman that he lost his son. And you feel compassion for your family, relatives and family that don't know the Lord. And you feel compassion for your friends that they don't know the Lord. Do you feel compassion for your neighbor that they don't know the Lord? And you feel, do you feel compassion for all these people around you that they are lost without Jesus Christ? First one, please, don't forget that the peace of the Lord move us to compassion. Every day we must feel compassion for the people who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. In second place, when the Lord saw him, he had compassion on him and said, "Don't cry." I reminded the Lord Jesus Christ near to the woman. Maybe he touched her and said, "Please, don't cry. There is hope for you. I will do something great for you." He was consoling her. He was giving her hope. The visit of the Lord moved compassion and moved for a hope. Many people live without any hope. And we have the only hope of the world that is Jesus Christ. And we mention with people that when the Lord visits you, not only give you compassion, no, it's not only he moved the compassion, but he also showed that you move to hope to the people. When you see in the Bible, Luke chapter 4, when Jesus Christ opened the Bible, and he said, Luke chapter 4, verse 18, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the captives and recovery of sight of the blind, to see free to the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." You see, Jesus Christ here in 17 and 19, he said that the Lord was preaching, or also because he came to healing the people that are in problem. In Selwyn, one day, he said, go again to, please, thank you, go to Luke 7. he gave hope, don't cry. And in the same place, the peace of God gives a touch of love and hope. Then he came up and touched the open coffin. And he said to the man, John, raise. And the Lord raised that young people. When the Lord Jesus Christ arrived to our life, and he touched us, it's a special touch of love, compassion, forgiveness, and a new life. The death will change in life. The sorrow was changed in happiness, in joys. That mother suffering by the loss of her only son, now she was happy. I imagine praise the Lord because her son was raised from the dead. That is what the Lord Jesus Christ do in our life. When the Lord touch our life is a new life. And the last thing that I would like to share with you in this morning said, the dead man sat up and began to speak. The visit of God must be proclaimed. My friends, my brothers and sisters from Canada, don't lose any opportunity to share with your friends, with your parents, your relatives, your friends, your neighbors, the peace of God in your life. When he was raised, he began to speak. I demanded that he began to speak what the Lord Jesus Christ made in his life. Take every day a time, an opportunity to share with some people your testimony. Don't change religion. Share your testimony, what the Lord Jesus Christ has done in your life, and how you have the blessing to have now your personal Savior in Jesus Christ. We in Cuba are praying to the Lord that He may give us compassion for the Cuban people, that they are lost without Jesus Christ. And every day we pray, Lord, give us compassion for the people that they don't know the Lord. This is my calling to you this morning, that you may feel compassion for the lost people, and you may share that in Jesus Christ is hope, we have hope, and in Jesus Christ there is a touch of love and life. And you may be very happy and so joyful to share with the people that in Jesus Christ is the only hope for the world and for this country too. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for all the blessings that we feel in the Bible. We ask for these people this morning. These youth people, all the people here in the church. Thank you for you, because one day in our life, you visit us. And now we feel your presence. And we are so grateful that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. But my Lord, there is many of our families, our relatives, our neighbors, our friends, that they don't know you. They are lost without a hope in their life. Like this man in this story, they are dead and they need to be raised for you. Please, we ask for this church that all these youth people may feel compassion for the people that they are around them and they don't know you. And every day they may proclaim that in Jesus Christ we have salvation, we have hope, we have a new life. Lord, we ask you to continue blessing Pastor Danny, his family, all these people here in the church, the Chinese church too, and for the testimony of these people, many Canadians and many foreign people here may know that you visit us in a special way for bless our life. Thank you, Lord, for this time in the name of Jesus.